I'm a curious man with some curious genes. I get that from my dad. I'm no far from.
Hi everyone, how are you? It's a little too loud for me. Okay, so welcome to the stream. What are we gonna do today? So today we are going to work on Maya ZBrush workflow. What we are going to do is, so I've already prepared a few parts of my architecture. This one is already exported. I'm going to export another one here. And we will see as we go how many we are able to work on. So the idea for that workflow is to so when you have a part of an architecture, it can be a prop, it can be whatever you want, actually, you just have to prepare the UV so that every edge is that you need to, that you want to be an holding edge, a supporting edge, needs to have an is on UV. Like if I'm showing you on this one, you see every different color is a different UV set. So of course it's not the best way to UV your prop in the end. You don't want that result at all. But for the purposes of what we are going to do, this is really helpful. It's quick to do. It's really, really fast. If you use the 3D cut and sew tool. So you just have to click on the edges that you want to cut, and then you lay out all of your UVs like that. You don't really have to be careful of how the UV space is used or whatever. You just need the UV island to be separated the way you want. And normally, if we are going to ZBrush, which is already open, and that we are trying to import our, of course, meshes, ZBrush, and we're going to take the first one, open it. Just drag it in, hold shift to keep it straight, and F. Okay. So I need to use the perspective, or else it's kind of weird, actually. And from there, so you have your element here, like that. Okay, backside is not modeled because this is something that we won't see in the scene in the end. Okay, very good. So from now you are going to click Shift F. Shift F will show you the poly groups. Of course, there's none for now. And as you can see, I have personalized UI on ZBrush because there's a lot of tools that I'm using oftenly. Some, I'll be honest, all of those, I'm trying to use those, but I'm still not sure how to use it properly. But I still keep those because sometimes it works, so sometimes I don't think it works. I'm not sure. It must be me. Trust me, it's not the program that has an issue. But what we are going to use now is this one. So this one is auto group with UV, which is why we did what we did before. If you do that up, there you go. You have lots of UVs everywhere, a lot of different poly groups. Okay. Then, when you have that, you are going to use crease poly groups there. And if I do that, you will see that yeah, all of the supporting edges were done properly. Okay, and from there, if I subdivide that, so Control D, I'm going to re-click Shift F because I don't want to see the poly groups. But as you see, I've subdivided it. And it's clean. It's extremely clean everywhere. Just have to check that you didn't forget anything. But it seems to be really, really, really nice. So, we are going to subdivide it a little more. 4 million polys is. Yeah, it's okay. Anyway, we are going to dynamesh it in the end, because what you want there also, that as you can see, I didn't have any edges around here or here, right in the middle. So the way the polygons, the vertices will be displayed all around, it's not the best, not the best at all. So we are going to increase the resolution because I want a lot of polys there to be able to sculpt on it, and we are going to dynamesh it. Oh, I always do that. So you can say yes, but it probably won't work. Anyway, I'm going to show you what I did wrong there. Okay, so you see, I don't have any polys there. So I'm going to Control Z because, as I told you, for in every streams I'm doing, I love Control Z. And what you need to do before the dynamesh is to delete the lower subdivisions. So you are going to delete that. As you can see, there's a lot more polys, but still not evenly distributed. So I'm just going to dynamesh it a bit. As I said before, dynamesh, it will be a little longer than the first time, of course, because there's a lot more polys to dynamesh. And hopefully it won't crash, and it did not crash. And as you can see, it's, well, you don't see a lot, but you can still see that this is way better. See, it's evenly distributed everywhere. It's better to sculpt on that. It would be way faster, way easier, not faster, but way easier. Okay, and we have 10 million polys, which is a lot, but that's okay. To sculpt on it, that's okay. It's not an issue at all. This one is not great. Okay, so we have a mistake there that I did not spot. Why? I'm going back there. Okay, so that's why, I think. So you see here, I made a mistake there. So I should have cut the UV here, just to make sure that because I'll show you. I have the crease there, but when you are subdividing, you see what it's doing? It's not keeping it straight, and same here. So that is not what we want at all. So we are going to need to go back to Maya. So hold a second. Let's go back to Maya. So there we have our prop, and we are going to use the tool I was saying before. Cut here, cut there, and I'm pretty sure, I'm wondering if I'm not supposed to. Yeah, it's cut there, and here too. Ooh. Yeah, it's cut, so we are good for the rest. Okay, so from there, sorry, you can't see what I'm doing right now, but it's going to take just a second. Okay. I laid out the UVs a second time, just to make sure that you have space between everything. I'm not sure it does a difference, but I prefer having something clean. Okay, so from here, what are we going to do? So here, I'm going to, I'm not sure if I exported it the right way. Did I export it? I did not. So, okay, it's done. And so here, there we go. So normally it replaced the one I had there because it's the same name. So as long as you don't have any modifications on the structure of the mesh, you shouldn't have any issue. It's going to replace it, or else you just go back to a new file and you're good to go. Okay, so let's auto group with UV. So I have my cut here and here. And so now I'm going to crease by polygroup, and if I subdivide, yeah, this is clean. See, I have my angle way better than before. Okay, we're good for that. Great, great, great. So I'm just going to subdivide a little more. Do not make the same mistake as before. We are going to delete the lower subdivisions. From there, we are going to crank up the resolution for the dynameshing. Maybe a little less because 10 million. Yeah, 2500, around 2500 is fine. And yeah, we are good. So let's dynamesh. If, yeah. Okay. So we have to let the program do a thing. There we go. I think we're good. Yeah, that's perfect. Okay. So, will have a lighting problem, but that's okay. Just, okay. So, the first thing that I'm doing now is to I'm going to smooth a little all of the edges everywhere because it's nicer and also it would be easier to sculpt on those if I okay, I did something I shouldn't have done there and I do not know how to correct that. Okay, now I know. Okay, so I am going to lower the size of that. 4 is okay. Just hold shift and smooth those angles a little bit. You don't have to be perfect because this is going to be stone and the stone is not perfect in real life. So you have to, you don't have to have something perfect. There's something that you will see in that workflow. It's that, oh, it's that sometimes the mistakes that you're going to make while modeling will help you because you're going to do something, a dent or something like that, and you're like, oh, what did I just do? And in the end, if you look at it, if you have a better look at it, you'll see that it's actually a good thing for your model. So, you see what I'm doing on the edge here? It's gonna be way nicer. It gives a better, a nice highlight on the side there. I won't need it in there, but the exterior parts, the sharp ones, yeah, I do. So that takes a lot of time to do. I would agree with you, but I know that there are some ways to use the polish there, but when you do that, it's like for an example, let's check that this one, just so you see. It's supposed to, oh, it did work, right? Oh yeah, it did work. Ooh, let's do this. Here you go with some issues again. See, so that's the thing that I have that problem all the time. I forget some parts and I have to go back. But I've just realized that the polish by crease edges will work, so we will use that. So let's go back again to Maya. And in Maya, I'm going to actually, I think I'm going to just a second. Okay, sorry about that, guys. I was just trying to make it work. And so what I'm going to do now is to use which screen? No, I'll use this one. There you go. Okay, so now you can see everything. You can see normally up there, so I have my UVs there, which it's far from perfect. You can't have something like that when you want to texture on it. Okay, this is not what you need at all. Okay, but this is what I need for the purposes of what I'm doing now. And I'm going to cut here and here, here, here. Okay, here, 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 and here. Okay. 3D cut and sew tool. I'm telling you, this is what you need to use. So is it okay? Yeah. So see here. I didn't go to the other side yet of my model, and I noticed some things that I forget. So okay. I think it's better now. Yeah, okay. So I'm going to use, I'm selecting all of my UVs, and I have a tool here that will allow me to lay out everything quite correctly. At least it's enough for what I need. And I'm going to go back to the tablet. There we go. Okay, so now hi Julien, thank you. And there we go. So we are going to try and import that again, and of course it doesn't work because so yep, no, sorry, you have to open a new document. I don't want to save anything in there. There we go. Okay. So this one should be okay. Let's try that. Yeah. Control D. So I forgot to crease. There we go. Yeah, way better. Okay, we're good now. Are we perfect everywhere? We seem to be. Yeah. Okay. So now, let's. Again, see, I forget every time. Delete lower and dynamesh. Okay. Sometimes it takes. Yeah, it takes a long time to get what you want. Okay, there we go. So we are clean everywhere, right? There's no, I'm not going to have a bad surprise somewhere. Doesn't seem like I will. Okay, so now seeing that it worked, Polish. use that. Score 30. I didn't see the difference, you see. I did not see anything. What if I polish my group? Yeah, it's better. It's giving me this, and I'm not sure I want that, but okay. Let's try the so if anyone knows what difference does okay. So I have no idea what it's supposed to do as a difference, but it gave me a result that I quite like. It was way too strong, but yeah, again too strong. Maybe I should just type one. Yeah, nice. Okay. Well, I think now we can go directly into the sculpting part. Okay, so you are not seeing that. Yeah, thank you, Junior. You won't see that, but I have brushes down there. You can see just the top of it, because I have it on my UI, because those are the brushes that I use all the time. So I'm going to go there. But if you want to check which one I'm using normally, yeah, it's gonna be just right up there, so you will be able to see what I'm using. The first one that I'm using, so I'm using all of the brushes from Orb. You can get that, I think, on Gumroad. You will be able to find that, and they're free, so you just have to download it and then try and install it, which is not the easiest step, but it's pretty doable, don't worry. I managed to do it, so you should be able to. And from there, I'm going to start with the corner up there. Too big, so you have to select a size you're comfortable with. Don't worry if it's not working at first, you just go back. Again, Control Z works wonders, and all we want is to create that those irregularities on the sides, just like that. You don't need to have something too much. We want something really subtle, but it will make a big difference once you. Maybe I should just leave it like that. No, I shouldn't. It will make a big difference when you bake it afterwards. Just let me have a look at that. That's okay. See, sometimes you're not sure you're doing something that seems like you missed. But in the end, it can have a great value, added value on your assets. So I'm not pressing too much on my pen right now, but this one might be a bit too much. See, this one is it's not gonna work. That's sometimes you have a dent like that, and when you look at it from afar, it gives you a nice little detail. Something like that, for example, will do. And this too. This should be fine. You always have to, if you look from further away, like you know that your prop like is gonna be that far, so it's not that obvious at all. It's just going to give it that real that realism that you need. And trust me, it does make a difference. I used to not do that, and you can have the best texture in the world, you can have the best base modeling in the world. If you don't add those, it will show. You'll notice that there's something weird, not well, too sharp to everything that you do. So you need to add those little details to your to everything that you do. Well, it depends on the material. Of course, this is stone, so stone has to be unperfect. I'm not sure we can say that. But I'm pretty sure you understand what I mean by that. Yeah, we're good there. And yeah, I know that wood, you don't always need to do something like that with wood. But stone, yeah, it's important. Like wood, sometimes you can have a nice result just with textures, but it will depend on what kind of wood you're going for. So for an example, I will have some wood in my scene, but I'm pretty sure that I'll take it to ZBrush because I want it to be not damaged but used, you know, like really, really used. And in order to do that, I will have to. That's ugly. Oh. Yeah, I still don't like it. So yeah, what I was saying, yeah, about the wood, you will need to for the result I want to achieve, I will need to take it to ZBrush. I'm pretty sure. Yeah, that's better. So one mistake that I'm always making, and you shouldn't, is to scope from too close sometimes, especially for that part. Because if I'm doing it from too close, I will focus too much on one point, and I won't get the overall shape, which is not the best. You'd prefer having the general shape and go along it. I can go back to that. Can I use that for it? No, I can't. Now it's gonna mess this up, so maybe just go back to my flatten. Yeah, perfect. So just I use the smooth tool, just click shift, just hold shift. And get a nice result. Okay. Now. Also, I'm not just doing one stroke. I'm giving one stroke, then another, then another. Because I want to be able to control where I'm. See, this one seemed like a mistake, but if you are looking at it like that, it will look good. It will. That's for sure. I've tried it already, and I'm saying this one will look good. Just need to. Maybe. I'm not sure I did something there, but that's okay. Okay. So, And let's keep going. Like that. That was a good one. So yeah, I was saying just different strokes, not just one, because you will have a better control, especially with you can control Z again. Yeah, I know I'm annoying with the control Z, but this is really helping. It will be a really good help for you. So also one thing, you don't want to have details that are too obvious, especially for my scene, because I think you saw what the scene is supposed to look like in the end, and there's a lot of repetition on the, especially on the architecture, and you don't want it to be too obvious. So if you have details that are too much, it would be obvious. Like for an example, if I wanted to make a big crack, I could only use it for one or two of the pieces around the main part of the scene, or else it would be way too obvious. So I don't know why sometimes it does that. Okay, so this is okay, because see the asset would be further away like that, so it's not an obvious detail. It seems obvious from a close range, but it's not. And always go a little further back, like go back to your object like that and see it from a distance that is supposed to be seen from, if I'm making any sense, so that you have a real feel of what it will look like in your scene. Okay. Yeah, something like that would be enough. Use shift to your advantage. So I don't know. I've seen a lot of people use ZBrush, so, and not a lot use that. So just hold shift once, and you will have the 90 degrees snapping. And also, if you use shift and you start to move on the side like that, but you let go of shift, it didn't work, of course. Why doesn't it work? That's a weird thing. It doesn't want to work. Oh yeah, okay. That's up and down. I don't know why. Well, it doesn't work with this asset. I don't know why, but maybe it's too big. I don't know. But normally, if you hold shift and let go, you can have you can rotate from left to right. Sometimes it's convenient to use it like that. So you might have noticed too that I'm not doing that angle because it's not going to be useful. Like the way it's presented in my scene, I don't need to work on that one. So I am not. Let's not lose any time on something that we won't see, right? Okay. You can also try to add details on those lines, I don't know. I don't think it's not supposed to be the ones that are getting damaged the first, so it's not obvious that you need some, and it's a little more difficult to do also because it's in the inside. So I don't know. So I'm personally not bothering doing that. and the end result were great. So, I mean, must mean that somewhere I did something right. I like this one. This one is nice. Let's keep moving. Okay. And I have quite a few parts like that. This is just the bottom of the column, and I have all of the column to do the balcony, the there's a lot to do. So yeah, it takes time to do that. But if you want something that is clean, it's like everything. You need to give time to whatever you do in order to have a good result, you know? Something you can't rush. You cannot rush good things. Sorry. Okay, that's nice. Okay. And as you can see, that brush, that flattened orb brush, it does the job like pretty nicely. You have other brushes like that can help you, like those ones. This is a slash one. I'm just going to show it to you, but I'm not going to keep it like that, okay? But it's just a dragging brush, and you can add some dents like that. Well, this one is ugly, of course, but you can play with the intensity and everything, and it will give you, sometimes you can have some really nice results. This one is ugly, and for example, if you just crank it up there and do something like that, and you just have to refine it afterwards, but look from afar, that's quite nice, isn't it? But I'm not using those, not right now anyway. Where was I? Where was I? Oh, and there's the pinch one too. The pinch one is nice, especially for those parts here. If you want it to be tighter, like it doesn't show, it's not that obvious now, but it can work for those parts and also for some cracks that you're doing to make it a little th And my mic went off again. So yeah, you can play with multiple brushes. Also, you have to remember that I'm using that brush because I like to use that one since I've tried it. But if you are more comfortable with another one, there are so many brushes that you can use. As long as you're comfortable with it, you can use any brush you want. It's like when you're working with a 3D software like Maya or Max, there's thousands, maybe not thousands, but hundreds of different ways to work, and none are the best and none are the worst, you know what I mean? It's everyone has his own way of working, and everything works as long as the end result is good. I'm not sure about this one. It's kind of too obvious. I don't know. Check it. So I have Chris, make sure you zoom out a fair bit to check if the details you are adding are readable from a distance. Yeah, that's what I was saying before. To go far away. And I think some of those can't read quite well, but this one up there doesn't seem to be the best. I'm not sure about this one. Oh, does that. But yeah, that's I totally agree. Don't be afraid to exaggerate. Yeah, I know that that's exactly what I was saying before. The fact that we need to be far away because sometimes it seems like it's a big hole that we made, but in the end, when you look at it, like it's supposed to be seen like this small. And so the big hole that you made when you were zoomed in, you just don't see it anymore. So I know that I know it's kind of hard to implement, let's just say. But yeah, I agree with you. I need to. Ah, this is too much. I need to go a little more in depth with that. I'll try to add some, but I don't want to like for those ones, for example, I'm happy with those and those ones too. Maybe I should go further. I don't know. It's not that thick there, so I have to admit that I'm afraid for to have something that would be too much, but yeah. This one is gonna read well. You're gonna see it, no issue, that's for sure. So yeah, I have to. I'm going too fast, and then it's worrying instead of zooming in. I say this is the thing that you need to be able to watch for. It's the It's kind of difficult to exaggerate too much sometimes because you feel like it's going to be way too obvious, but in the end, in your scene, it's not that obvious at all. And if you don't give some big things to see, then you won't see anything at all. And all of the work that you would have done will be for not for nothing, but almost. Hi, pro programmer. I don't know who you are, but hi, welcome. This one was not enough for sure. So I'm going to add a little more and I'm going to do it from afar. So it's better. Okay, here we go. Back to where we were. And we are going to create those imperfections. I think I'll keep that one. Especially this is the bottom part of the colon, so it should be the most damaged part. So Let's give it a little more. But also, this is the side, so it might not be the one. I think the more damages will be around here, for sure, because the column is supposed to face like that. Okay, so normally this line and this line will be the most damaged parts. So, stop doing that. Too much. Way too much. Okay, let's keep going. See, sometimes I don't know why it does that. Must be me, but I'm going in like that and nothing happens. See? Why did I change the... Okay. Just realized that I changed the brush without wanting to do that. So, yeah, works better when you have the right brush, of course. Okay. So let's keep going. You don't need to spend like too much time on those parts, but it still does take some time to do it. And ZBrush is a... It's not the easiest program to learn, if I'm being honest. And I remember that Julien was saying that in his stream the other day, and I so agree with him. ZBrush, sometimes it's quite difficult to use. It's more drawing, and drawing is not my specialty at all, which is probably the reason why I'm better with Maya or Max. No. I'm wondering if this one... Yeah, this one will be okay. I'll keep it. Let's keep going on those edges. This is the moment where you feel like maybe you shouldn't have put so many edges everywhere. And I had way more edges at the beginning. But I was told, and I think it's the right thing to do, to tone it down a little. And I'm starting to feel that even time-wise, it was a good idea. It's better. Not too much. Way too much. Okay. We are getting there. So, from afar. I think it would be enough. So I'm just gonna keep it like that. And anyways, if I feel like it's not enough at one point, I can always go back to that, because I'll still have the fight. So if I feel like there's something missing in there, what I will do anyway, every time I do that, when I finish my ZBrush workflow, I will go to Painter or Marmoset. You can do that in Marmoset too, and I will bake my high poly on my low poly just to see if the result is satisfying or not. Not too much. And I will add a simple texture on it, so it will give me a good idea of what the end result will be, and I'll see right away if I'm missing something or not. That's crazy how much, like, if I'm going, yeah, I didn't realize that. It feels like, I don't know if it's true, it's probably not true, but it feels like when I'm zooming in, I have less intensity in my brush. That's weird. Again, probably me, that is using the tool not as good as I could. But that's okay, it's all part of the training. I was discussing with a former teacher of mine last night, and that's exactly what we were saying. When you're working in 3D, you need to keep updated on everything, because everything is moving so fast that you always have something to learn. That's what makes it interesting too. The ZBrush is, I don't know, it's something that I didn't, it's what I was saying before, I didn't use it before. Not that much, because I didn't really see the point, if I'm being honest. I do see the point now, trust me. But it means that I need to keep using and improving the pro and improving on that program, on that software. And see, that's what I said. This one I didn't intend to do it like that, but if you see that it's going to be to look nice on your asset, then by all means, just keep it. And sometimes this is how I get those exaggerated. Oh, sorry, that word is hard. Those exaggeration on yeah, those, you know, those elements that you need to pop out like that. It's, it could be mistakes sometimes that are getting a good result. It's the same, you know what? I had the same thing with my modeling in Maya actually, not that long ago. I was using, I don't remember what it was, but I think it was like I was trying some kind of an extrusion or something, and I did a mistake. I really did a mistake, and the result was actually not bad, and I reused the same mistake kind of. Well, I turned it into a workflow kind of. That was funny, and the end result is really nice. You'll probably see it. I could show you later, but this is on the columns, on the top part of the columns. There's some things that that are a little more detailed, and I was, as I was working on it, I wanted a really nice extrusion, you know, something that was really straight, like a line, just like that, you know, no waves or whatever. But the way I extruded it gave me a wave, actually, some kind of a wave. It's not really, you can't really see, it's not that obvious, but it's just what it, what you need to give it a little. A little twist, and the end result is really nice. I really loved it, so I kept it. And now I know that when I do those kinds of things, I can. Isn't that too high? No, it's gonna be good. Okay. And now I know that I can use the tool like that in order to have a different variation on the way it looks on my extrusion. So, you know, just test it out, and sometimes you will be surprised. Yeah, just a little damage there, and let's go back up top. Okay. So let's continue. You see, there's a lot of it looks better already. And not everything reads, I would agree, but enough reads to get that old kind of vibe on the stone. And also the, so maybe it's just me, but I feel like the viewport in ZBrush is not that accurate sometimes. Maybe it's the Maybe it's the material here that I'm using that is not the right one, but I don't know. Maybe I should try another one. This is the. Which material is that? Startup? What if I try this one? See, with this one, it's way better. Okay. I'll keep going with this one. See? We are always learning. I didn't know that. Going to need, yeah, something like that here. And I'm kind of afraid of going there now because I know I will need a little more damaged parts. It kind of freaks me out, but it's gonna be okay. Okay, good. This has to be like that. It looks okay. Okay. Let's keep going. That part of the job is sometimes can feel repetitive, but I mean it's fun to do, actually. The thing also with that is that when you see the end result, usually you're, yeah, that's a nice feeling. Because you see that you didn't waste your time at all. You actually gave life to your model. And that's a really good feeling. When you feel like something that you did, you can put it in the scene and it will look like it's real, like, you know? This is the idea behind everything that we do in 3D, right? Well, unless you're going for stylized, but I am not right now, so. Stylized is complex, really complex. We have another streamer like Julien. I don't know if he's still on the stream, but he's going for a stylized environment. That's nice. I really like the way it looks and everything. We've seen it work on on a few pieces. So he's still on the stream. Yeah, but those crazy ones. I'm not sure what you mean, Julien, on this one. Not entirely sure. Because the thing is that if I go. The way I understand what you're saying is that I should go on cleaner parts like that instead of the edges. But I would look I don't know. So what I was saying about Julien actually is that he's working on style. He did a few stylized things, and it looked amazing. Like, if I'm being honest, it was really, really good. I can't wait what he's doing next. Okay. 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 Let's keep on going up there. I'm not doing the backside because it's. Oh, we won't see it in the scene at all. So. I'm not going for it. Yeah, I don't think it's useful to. Ooh. Not sure about this one. Okay, so Julien was saying not to add too much everywhere, but just a few ones that are clearly seen, which makes sense. But yeah, I don't know. Did you mean something like that? Yeah, okay. I think I get what you mean. The idea is to do something a bit bigger, and you can really see those details instead of having this 1,000 smaller ones. Yeah. I get it. Makes sense actually. Does make it's probably what Eddie was trying to tell me earlier, actually, when he was saying don't be afraid to exaggerate. And that's exactly what I was saying before, you know, about that. It's that you need to learn that, and you need to learn that this is working, you know. It's okay to go to do something like that. Yeah, I think it makes sense what you're saying, Julien, to be honest. There's something a bit more. Yeah, think I'll go for that because I did waste quite some time on the other edges when I can do just a few like that. Go here, don't really pay attention to what I'm doing, and maybe make another one a little bigger here. Like that. Yeah, and keep going down. Yeah, okay, I get it. I understand the okay. Thank you guys. Thank you very much. On top of that, it should make things easier and faster for me, so I'm not going to complain about that at all. Okay. Okay. Need to do those on this side too. 'Cause I'm kind of forgetting about this side. Okay. I don't know why. Maybe one of you can explain if you're still there. I don't know why sometimes on those edges I need to smooth it out, or else I can't really sculpt on it, which is weird. I don't know why it does that. There must be a reason that I don't quite understand yet, but edge first, then use the old brush trim dynamic. Maybe this one. Oh, you mean to really kind of cut the edge and create a some kind of a bevel with it? Use the old brush to flatten the details. Use it only where you want the damage. Okay, and the trim dynamic to create that kind of a bevel, right? Trim adaptive. Which one is the trim adaptive? Ooh. Dynamic is better. Okay, so I'm going to so not all the way down, use it like you were using the orb brush. So just gonna control Z all that what I did here. Okay. And then I am going to there's something that I do here that I like to do is enable customize down there. I'm going to grab that brush, the dynamic. It's Alt Control. Yeah, Alt Control, and I'm going to take that here. Store the config. Okay, so I will have my brush all the time. I like that. And then you want me to use it like that a little. Okay. I think I'll have to train a little with that. A square alpha. Use it's not there. Is there a reason for the square alpha? Makes it look chunkier, okay. Okay, I get it. Just so you can kind of cut the borders like that. Way too much. do you open that? Slightly bigger brush. Okay. And so I don't really need to touch those edges there in the end. I just have to go look here and there for a place to create some leave some okay, so really just go and put a damage here, put a damage there, put okay. I don't like that corner. I'll go back to it. That's okay. That was the flat. Okay. Mistake from me. I'll try it again. Because I need to get that technique. Okay. So. Okay. Try and cut the stone like that. Something like that. And then we'll go with the flat and try to lower that a little just to flatten the part. Make it look more stony. Like that. We'll look at that from further away. Okay, I get it. Okay. So I'm going to have to be able to decide. Why doesn't it? Okay, it doesn't want me to take that. I don't know why. See? So it doesn't let me take the brush that I want, which is weird. I don't know why. Brush trim. Okay, I can't use the dynamic anymore. That is just great. So you know what? I'm just going to save the project. Okay. Just going to try and relaunch ZBrush. I just saved. Let's go. There it works. I don't know why it did that. That's a weird thing. Ah, of course I don't have that. Seems to work like that. It's way too flat. Try to use a smaller brush just for the flattening part of it. Okay, let's try it like that. Give something. Something because I can't put that everywhere, so I have to figure out where I should add those. Okay. Let's go for the So I got, some nice results there. I think I'm gonna try and do some that are smaller. Should I put another one? I think I'll leave another one by there. Something like add a little one here. Nothing too much. Yeah, just a small one. I think I really need to lower the brush for this one if I want a result. So okay. Yeah, okay, I got it now. Makes it a little more difficult to put it randomly, but the look is really nice. Bigger pieces. Yeah. Okay. Let's try to add something. Something like that. Thank you, Julien. Okay. Okay, so now I'm going to try and do some damages here. This angle, should I put one here? I think I should. And in the middle too. It's not damaged at all now. It should be. I don't know why the light does that. It's just annoying. What's the H polish brush? This one? Yeah. I'm not sure what it does exactly. You mean just a little bit like that to remove the too much noise? Okay. Okay, get it. Okay. See, so that's a new technique that I'm learning now, and so I need to focus like crazy. But that's okay. It's always good to learn new tricks. The more tricks you have, the better you'll be. Okay. Okay, so I think I'm gonna try to do a couple more and then I will leave you at that, because it's been quite some time now that I've been live and I need to take a break. So we are going to try and add some that technique. I have a damage here. I don't want damage at the same place. I'm going to try something that I never tried. Not that I tried a lot of those things before. If someone has a trick for the light, I'd like to know, because it's annoying to have the light like that, but something like that. Too much this one. I'll use the flatten for this one. Yeah. So. Where's the brush? Edge polish. How did you call that? The edge polish, yeah. I should have it up there. I'm going to take it. Customize. And it was this one here. And I'm going to register that so that I keep the brush with me at all times. So this might be a bit intense. How should I correct that? Like that. Okay. To use the polish like in a small brush, I believe, because you don't want to lose completely your details. But yeah, I get the idea to remove the unwanted noise. Okay, that looks nice. That's what I thought. But you really need to use it with a small brush, like it's really for the noise that the brushes are leaving behind. Sometimes you don't want that much noise on your mesh, and that polish seems to do the work. Oh, see what it did, the polish there? It's weird. That's because I wasn't in the polish mode. Okay, now I am. Okay, well, seems nice. I think I'm getting the hang of it, which is really cool. And I also believe that I'm going to leave it at that, at least for the stream. I might keep working on that for a while today, and I will post the results later. But anyway, it's been 2 hours in your company. It was really nice, everyone. I hope you enjoyed the stream. I was a bit focused at the end. I'm sorry, but I was learning something new. So sometimes it's a bit harder to talk while working. But yeah, thank you very much for following the stream. Don't forget that Julien will be live tomorrow. I think it's at 2, but I'm not entirely sure. I'm sorry, Julien, I forgot. But you will have a message on the probably. I don't know if you will leave a message on LinkedIn or something like that to tell everyone that you are going live. But don't forget to tune in tomorrow. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, everyone, and have a good day. Bye.